In the last session, I asked you to guess laws of elimination, and I gave you hints on there are two laws of elimination. I believe some of us must have tried. Anyways, we will move on to this lecture number 14 of this electrical services and elimination E6 in our series. We will start with in the last module, we studied about quality and quantity of lighting, recommended lux levels for various spaces as per the standards, types of lamps, and in this module, we will talk about integration of ray lighting with artificial lighting, control systems and strategies, laws of illumination. We will start with the laws of illumination. There are two laws of illumination, one is inverse square law, and the next one is Lambert's cosine law. Of which I will tell you, we are just going to brush up these. Though this is a repetitive question in your V2 exams, so for definitions, I would recommend all of you to do a Google or refer reliable materials for these definitions. So the inverse square law is, in fact, very simple. I will tell you what is an inverse square law. Lambert's cosine law. I would ask you to find it out by yourself, right? Inverse square law is nothing but in a layman terms, it is very simple. Whatever is a light source, the light that is getting emitted from this source and the intensity or the light that it is going to reach the surface is going to decrease. This is obvious, common sense. The more you increase the surface from the light source, the amount of the quantity of light that is going to fall in this particular plane is going to reduce. But what inverse square law tells us is it reduces in a much rapid pace that we would normally think that it would reduce. So it is not gradually reducing, it is going to rapidly reduce, and that is what is inverse square law. Basically, for every distance that you are going to increase, it is going to decrease by double the amount of the distance that you are going to increase. Just because the distance is in the denominator, the intensity that is falling on a surface is going to decrease in doubles. So that is your inverse square law. Lambert's cosine law is again for a different purpose. So why do we have to study this over here is the entire illumination works based on this philosophy, the laws. So this is inverse square law. Like I told you, Lambert's cosine law, I leave it up to you. Do a Google search, refer materials that you have, and go for the definitions. So now that we have completed the laws of illumination, we are now getting into the daylighting aspects of it. So daylighting, we know what is a daylight. Whatever is being received from the natural source, the only natural source is sun. Whatever is received from there is daylighting, right? But now, as per the syllabus, it talks about not just daylighting, but integration of daylighting with artificial lighting, right? So this is one example that I put here, which is Church of Light by architect Tado Ando. You can see how the play of natural light is combined with the artificial light. Probably in this image, we are not seeing the artificial light, but you can still see the wall fixtures in the left side of the wall. But otherwise, also, this is an efficient use of daylighting for an interesting purpose, right? And if you go back further in history, we have this Pantheon dome where the central portion is open, and as the sun moves, we get to see the sun which enters through the opening in the top of the dome, lighting different spaces inside the building in a particular day, right? So that moves along with the that varies along with the sun movement, right? And the next image I have put Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, by architect Uy Khan. So in this, we again see the example of how the artificial light is put into use with the openings. The openings are over here, the openings are very nicely, intelligently used. that it is used as a pattern creating element, right? And there is a play of light and shadow. Within the daylight, there is going to be a major play in the light and shadow. And apart from that, it is also illuminated artificially. And how these are playing, again, if you again see the pattern in which the ceiling hung lights are placed, is also at regular intervals, and we would probably have to know if that is also having any major play in recreating the pattern that is created in the day. Right. So with these examples, we will just know what is daylighting by definition. Daylighting is controlled admission of natural light, which is direct sunlight, and also diffused skylight into a building to reduce electrical lighting and saving energy. So I'll go again with the definition. Controlled admission of natural light. So it is not that we don't put a ceiling and say my space is completely daylit. That is not the idea. It is a controlled admission. That is where you as a designer is going to play a role. Controlled admission of natural light, direct light, and also diffused skylight into a building, right? So to reduce electrical energy and saving energy is the next step. It's in fact a byproduct of it. But if we intelligently use this, it can be used to create interesting patterns, and the strategies can also be interesting. And it may not just of daylight apertures where you just have openings in your fenestrations, but it is also coupled with daylight responsive lighting control system. So this is where I told you control system is not just a couple of switches. It comes as a system where it is also integrated with the daylighting strategies. Right. So some of the decisions that this can involve is about the passive daylighting strategies could involve building form, the way it's oriented, the climate, the building components, just your apertures like windows and skylights, the lighting control strategies and the lighting design criteria. Move further, daylighting. These are the components that can that one can consider while considering daylighting as a strategy. Daylight optimized building footprint. So it is a continuation from the previous slide, which is daylight optimized optimized building footprint. As we are talking in terms of the orientation, and next point is climatically responsive window to wall area ratio. You must have studied it in your climatology, which is in your third semester as per VTU syllabus, right? So we must have studied about window to wall ratio and how that can be combined with the climatological aspect so that the building responds climatically. The third component that we can consider is high performance glazing. When we see my windows glazed, it is not just about the glass that we are talking about. There are so many categories, types, values, technicalities involved in selecting the glass. So over here we are talking about high performance glasses. And fourth is daylighting optimized fenestration design. So your entire window, the placement of a window, the size of the window, the shape of the window, or any opening for that matter that is going to fall onto your fenestration has to be daylighting optimized. And skylights is of course a very popular idea of borrowing daylight. But skylights, depending upon the nature of the building and the typology that you have at your hand, so it is not possible to get a skylight, for example, in a multi-story building. So skylights have their own limitations, but yes, skylight has been a very good source of borrowing daylight. And these days we have tubular daylight devices which in fact borrows the light from the top of your building to the space where we actually need it. And there are daylight redirection devices. So in case of spaces where we can't directly borrow the daylight, so there are devices that has to be kept in tandem with the sun rays and the space that we want to lit up, so they can redirect the sun light. And we have this chajjas or overhang solar shading devices has to be made effectively, designed effectively. Next option is daylight responsive electric lighting control. So this is where we are slowly getting onto the lighting strategies and integration with the daylight. So we are talking about daylight responsive electric lighting controls. Is a very popular example, and simple example for this would be you have a sensor which automatically, or we have a timer sensors which automatically turns on the light at say 6:30 in the evening till 4:30 in the morning. Some of the very large townships, campuses have made it, have integrated this into their system, infrastructure system, where I've been, some of the IT companies that is one of the very popular IT companies that we have in Mysore is having this strategy incorporated in theirs. So every evening at around 6:37, the light, street lights automatically goes on by themselves. At around 4:30, it automatically goes off. So this way, they the margin of human errors is less, and they naturally save energy. They are able to plan for their budget in terms of the running hours and all that. And the last option which is listed here is daylight optimized interior design. This is something which we usually underestimate, for the fact that we have so many other things to focus in terms of our interior design, the placement, the function, the look and feel, the color schemes and all that. Whereas if we have to keep daylight also into consideration, the interior design and the colors that we choose and the way we design, the way we see the design, the scheme, all those can also be thought, re-looked or looked at from a daylight optimized perspective as well. Right. So we will try to look at, I will try to go through each of this in a, you know, a little more detail. First, we take the daylight optimist optimized building footprint. I told about this. It's about that optimal orientation that we can achieve. And the next is climate responsive window to wall ratio. So wall to window ratio is something which we have been studying since our semester 3. The window needs to have a careful balance between admission of daylight, because the moment we say we have an opening in a building, that also means it is going to invite heat. Right? So there are going to be heat gains, heat losses. So all that have to be carefully planned. From a lighting perspective, if you borrow so much of daylight and if a direct sunlight radiation comes in, and if it radiates, immediate diffusion of the sun's radiation causing over brightness and also even glare. So, right? So this has to be an important factor in considering your daylight components. And high performance glazing. So this is not just a thing that topic can be, that can be explained in just one slide. This entire topic of glazing itself is very broad and vast, and with the advancements that they make every second in the market, they're coming up with numerous strategies. We must have again studied about the U-value, reflectance, visual reflectance of the glass and all that again in your climatology. I just want you to know this as a high performance system or a glass which will generally admit more light and less heat. Right. So with over here, we will just stop with that. High performance glazing is something which allows more light and less, relatively less heat. Fenestration design, daylight optimized fenestration design. The window has two essential functions in a building. One is daylight delivery. Second is the view. So visual connectivity. We talk in terms of visual connectivity, permeability, and all that. So one is daylight delivery or getting it to the building. The next is if you really want to provide a view to the occupants between the spaces or from indoor to outdoor. So usually the daylight has visible relatively high light transmissions, whereas the other one, provision of view to the occupants, has a relatively low visible light transmittance. Skylights are of passive and active medium. Passive because they have a naturally diffusing medium. Active skylights have a mirror. This is again similar to the redirected sunlight devices. Active sunlights will have a mirror system within the skylight that tracks the sun, are designed to increase the performance of the skylight by channeling the sunlight down into the skylight well. Right? So this has set of devices which borrows, reflects, and within the skylight well, which finally brings down the sunlight to the space that you would want it to reach. Tubular daylight devices, the skylight well is replaced with let's say a tube here, employs high reflective film on the interior of a tube to channel light. So over here the element which is going to reflect is a high reflective film. that will borrow and channelize the light from lens at the roof to the place where you want through another lens, right? This can be done again in various ways. One example that I would remind you is about the periscope that we must have studied in our earlier schooling. You have one mirror here, another mirror here. Basically, you borrow something. It still works in cameras. Most of our DSLR works based on this concept. So this tubular light devices is something which is very similar to that. Daylight redirection devices. This takes incoming direct beam sunlight and redirect it generally onto the ceiling space. Right. So these devices are usually they serve two functions. One is glare control and daylight penetration. And these usually can take two forms. One is large horizontal element or lowered system. Horizontal daylight redirection devices are often called as light shelves. So if you are not familiar with the daylight redirection device terminology, it is nothing but the light shelf. The solar shading devices or overhangs is something which we all do. The problem is not with that we all do or we don't do. We have just made it as a standard, saying it has to project only for 2 feet and few inches. It is not about that every building with its in response to its context and surroundings and the size that side that is going to get exposed to the sun and which point of the day, depending upon all that we have studied in climatology, this itself is going to be a design strategy altogether. Not like I am going to put the same overhanging in all sides of my building, right? So this is again an underestimated component or a strategy which can be relooked again as the next generation architects. It would be a nice idea to look at all this again from the scratch and design our buildings accordingly. And this is where probably it gets into the lighting side of the syllabus. So daylight responsive lighting controls consist of continuous dimming. So it has several elements, components. One is continuous dimming, very similar to your last session I explained, very similar to your brightness that comes in your mobile, brightness sensor that comes in your mobile. So depending upon the amount of daylight that's getting in, that should be monitored through a sensor, and accordingly you can dim your daylights. Or there's something called a step ballast. Ballast is nothing but a big box that we see in your tube lights. Tube lights these days have it very it is integrated that you can't see anything out of it. But if somebody has gotten an opportunity to see the old tube lights where they have a stand and we used to have something called as a choke, and then there is a huge box in the center, right? So those are the ballast. So these ballast are part of every light fixture that we see. Just that some of the light fixtures it is openly seen, some of the light fixtures it is hidden inside. Even when you take a LED strip, it will have a small box. Depending upon the load, the box size will vary, but yes, ballast is the one which helps power up the light fixture. And one or more photocells to sense available light. So basically you have a combination of several components with a sensor which senses the amount of light entering inside and modify the indoor lights accordingly, that we save some energy. Daylight optimized interior design, it's something which I don't have to talk about. Most of you must have your own ideas and strategies and techniques about your interior design. But yes, all that I want to tell over here is just look at your ideas. Let all of your interior design ideas or stories or that you have in your mind, put them through a perspective of what if you have to optimize the daylight for your interior design, right? From what an LED light, LED strip can offer to what a wall washer can offer. So see if you can achieve the same interest and effect through daylighting. If that is the idea, how would your strategies, how would your thinking, how would your ideas change? Would it really change? This is a question that you should ask yourself. This also can be taken as a project, as an experiment to see how you your thought process changes if you have to achieve the same effect through the daylighting. And I'm just extending this discussion further. So now we have a different definition for the daylighting in terms of a strategy, in terms of light and lighting and an energy efficient strategy. So daylighting is an energy efficient strategy that incorporates many technologies and design philosophies. Right? A successful daylighting system will make use of the following technology types and construction methods. So one is exterior shading and control devices. We have already discussed about this. Glazing materials, aperture location, reflectances from room surfaces, we will come to this. Integration with electric controls, lighting control schemes. So most of it has been discussed in the previous slides. I would just throw some light over the ones which is not discussed much, which over here is reflectances of room surfaces. This probably we can argue that it is an interior designer strategy. So this can also get into the last point of the previous set that we discussed, which is the reflectances of room surfaces. But I also discussed about this in the previous lecture number 13, where I asked you to imagine a room full of white planes, side ceilings, walls, floors, everything white, and you put a white bulb, right? So reflectance of room surfaces over there, when I say we put a white bulb there, and all that these white painted walls are going to reflect is again white light, right? So what is actually reflecting? Now imagine the walls are again painted, not just with your distemper, but we have an emulsion, we have a reflected surface. Let's say to understand it better, imagine a 1 by 1 by 1 cube that we are making, a meter cube that we are making, and we are going to have one side of it with a polythene transparent plane, and we have paint, we have this glossy surface on all of these planes, all of the five other planes, with one being the transparent, and we have one white bulb coming on the center of this particular cube. So what happens over here is the glossy surfaces are going to reflect more light. So whatever this light is emitting in the center, it is going to hit all the surfaces, and they in turn are going to reflect further, and these reflections is not going to fade off anytime soon, and this is also constantly supplying more light. Right? So imagine the same cube, we are going to replace the glossy surfaces with the matte surface. So what happens? Right? So there will be a reduction in the reflection that we are going to see get in terms of the light that is producing, light that is emitting the radiation. Right? So now equate this to the room. So what are the types of surfaces that you are going to plan inside your room, which is going to reflect, which is going to absorb, which is going to diffuse the light that we are going to use? And when it comes to a daylight, I have this example where I have an east facing house. When I open the door in the morning and it is the second floor, so I have no obstruction in the front. The sunlight directly hits my floor, which is a glossy surface, which again reflects the same door's light pattern which is formed on the floor, which gets reflected to the showcase, which is made of glass, right? And the glass in turn again reflects it back to the ceiling, right? So it is just one reflection that is caused by the sun in one particular angle. So why I'm taking this example is because of the angle. So it comes in a particular angle, hits my floor, goes to the showcase, which is again a glass. From here it again goes back to the ceiling, right? So thankfully the ceiling is relatively less in reflectance, so it stops there, or probably it reflects back, which is not seen, right? So the opening sizes, the opening direction, and the reflectances of the room surfaces also play a major role in the daylighting strategies. Lighting control schemes, integration of with electrical daylighting, okay, we have covered. So the design, so we have something called as the design recommendations. So probably to just sum up all that we have discussed till now: optimizing urban design and building orientation, the perfect size, form, and glazing treatment for windows, shading for visual comfort and cooling, work with bright interior surfaces, move task areas close to windows, Consider daylight reflector systems, energizing building with solar radiation. So these are the basic and some of the passive design recommendations that we can make apart from our lighting control strategies. So from here, all that we have been discussing till now is about the daylighting strategies, both passive and active, and a combination of both. So from here we will jump to the, we have almost 5 to 10 slides left. We will jump to something called as a lighting control systems, right? So in a plain term, lighting control systems is nothing but your switch. I have been talking about this from the previous chapter session. Lighting controls are nothing but the switch. You put on a switch, put off a switch, it is going to make some change in the light that glows in front of you, right? So lighting controls are nothing but input output devices. Now we are talking about systems, so it is part of a system. The control system receives information, decides what to do with it. In other terms, receives information, processes the information, and returns back another command which will change the or adjust the lighting power accordingly. Simple as the control system receives an information, processes the information, and returns back a command on what's to be done. This is all done automatically. But imagine there are three of us in a tunnel, and I am in the middle of the tunnel, and there is somebody in the I am in the dead end of the, let's say, tunnel, and there is somebody who is 10 meters away from me, and there is somebody who is 20 meters away from them. So what happens is I have some work going on, so I have to switch a particular light on in the middle or end of the tunnel. So I have to indicate or tell my friend who is standing in 10-15 meters away from me, saying I need this light on. So that person receives the information, passes it to the other person who has the control switch for this light. So that person switches this on, and this is making a change. This bulb which is in the middle of the tunnel is going to see a change. So similarly, when I'm done with my work, I'm going to say switch that off, which is going to be received by my friend in the 10-15 meter range, and that person is going to pass the same information to the other friend who is in 20 meter range, right? So when this is all done automatically with the help of sensors and artificial intelligence system, that becomes our control system, right? Okay, that said and done, it is not that they will automatically do anything and everything. So we are going to, the human interference have to be there, at least in terms of the coding. They should know what's to be done when something happens. So this particular coding has to be done by the human beings, which our electrical engineers and the designers, according to the design strategies, will do, right? So lighting control plays a critical role in lighting systems, enabling users manually or automatically to switch the lights on and off, or adjust the light output up and down using a dimmer. So it is switching on, off, and the next usage here is modifying the range between the switching on and off, right? Equate this to the regulator that you have next to your fan switch. The speed of the fan varies. Some of you who must have done a science project or must have seen, I remember using the same fan regulator to adjust the brightness of a light as well, right? So basically, it is the amount of electricity that reaches the light, provided it has the range to handle that much of electrons entering in. So so one is turning on and off, and it's also about the a light output up and down using a dimmer, right? That is it in terms of this. Moving on to the next slide. So by adjusting the intensity of one or more layers of lighting in a space, lighting controls can, so by adjusting the intensity, this lighting controls can be used. So this is the slide where you're talking about, okay, we know that lighting controls have a particular purpose, they can do this, they can do that, yes, but what can they do? They can change the appearance of a space, right? So now imagine it is not just turning on and off, it is going to, you're going to have n number of lights zoned in a different fashion, and each of them switching on and switching off a different pattern. So this is one common example that we have seen, we can see in the Indian context, is the chowdhuries, the Kalyana mandapas that we see, and the LED lights that they hang during a function. So it depends upon the LED contractor on how he is going to illuminate it. And sometimes you see those lights running in a particular fashion. They all run in different colors in a set pattern, and there's a break also in between. Some of them just are evenly lit. Some of them have an interesting pattern going on. Some of them have a pattern going on within the strip. Some of them have a pattern going on between the strips. You know, the entire building gets lit in a different passion that becomes interesting, or probably not so interesting, whatever. That changes the appearance of a particular space. So when it is used in a much effective and, you know, it's not that. So that is basically a decorative element that we see in our Kalyana Mandapas. But over here, when in an interior space, when it is thoughtfully designed by an interior designer or a electrical consultant, electrical engineer, so it can help change the appearance of a space, right? And one of the recent examples that I tried is with the intelligent system, the Amazon's Alexa, Google Pod, and all that home automation systems that we have in market these days. When you set a particular, when you buy that with a smart light, and when you configure that with your device, when we say you know, when switch to work mode will change the color of the light, and when you say switch to reading mode, it again changes the color of the light, which can aid your reading, right? So these can also be configured. So this is something which anybody can just randomly order and try to use. So imagine doing this with a full thoughtful strategy for a huge setting or area of a space, right? So facilitating different functions at a particular space or of the space according to the lighting controls. And this again corresponds to the next point, altering atmosphere and the mood. So sometimes when again taking that LED or smart lights into consideration, they can produce numerous light combinations, varying the colors, changing the brightness and all that. So that is to alter the atmosphere and the mood. And by reducing the brightness, by dimming it or brightening up, we can also reduce the glare and increase the user satisfaction by providing users the ability to control their lighting. So if all said and done, the code or standard might recommend this much of light, but somebody who's really sensitive to the lights probably would find it very annoying, or you know, if they face too much of a glare. In such cases, it can be used to increase the user satisfaction by providing the ability to control their lighting. And we are in the end of this session, where I will just quickly run through the functions of lighting control system. One is to, we've been talking about this, switching on and off, and next is dimming, and the next thing is color and CCT control, which is which again I spoke about it with an example of reading and working. When I say work mode, I have more warm colors. We spoke about color temperatures, right? So we talk about the warm colors. When we are in the reading mode, we prefer cool colors and all that. So CCT is correlated color temperature. We spoke about the Kelvin and the visible, the range in the spectrum in terms of Kelvin, right? So and the last or the next thing is the input for the light control system. It can be manual or automatic. So if it is automatic, it has to be scheduled, it has to be programmed. If it is manual, so the first manual command is the one which triggers the entire set of operations, and this is relatively intelligent, of course, thanks to again the way, thanks to our researchers and all these people who are working on it. It is called as intelligent because of the programs and the risk, the low risk that in terms of an error, the human error, the error that a human could make. So relatively it is intelligence, and when it is programmed, we don't have to worry much about whether we have done it every under. When we do on a repetitive task, we probably sometimes might get to miss at times. So that worry is taken care here. And the design considerations, so this is the last of the discussion this in the session. Design consideration, we have control systems, under which I have these control systems can have, they can mean to control a particular zone. There is a particular narrative, the programs that we can talk about, and interoperability. So within the zones, within a particular set of strategy, how do you operate it within, operate a set or all of them together within them, the software that one could use to get all this up and running. It sometimes the one which I spoke about, the home automation ports that we have in India are being sold in the market as wireless. It can use a common Wi-Fi to communicate to each other. Sometimes it can be wired as well, right? And another important but not the least is commissioning. So after you get all of these guys talking to each other, so how do you commission them? So commissioning is again an important part of this entire system. And in the last few slides, I will just talk about what are the controls that we have. This again goes, we will talk about next slide, we will come back to the sensors in terms of a language of a sensors. Over here we have controls. So what all can we control? When we talk about this can be controlled, can be switched on or off and all that. So what can be controlled? So dimmer, there is a dimmer control which can help us control the dim or the brightness level. Next is motion sensor controls. Motion sensor controls are nothing but when it detects a motion, the lights are made to switch on. When occupancy sensor is again when you feel that there is some occupancy, this can again be sensed through different ways. Where if I remember when the thermal sensors that we have, senses the increase in temperature that it equates to the presence of occupants there, and it accordingly changes the strategies. So that photosensor controls, timer controls. Timer control is what I gave you in terms of the previous example that we spoke about for a township. And in this we have the control strategies. It can be manually controlled, it can be automatically controlled. Occupancy can be sensed, relates to the timer sensors. Daylight response, so depending upon the daylight response, it can be sometimes depending upon the day, sometimes the day is very gloomy that we probably need more light at 3 o'clock in the afternoon as well. So those days, these lights that we have, artificial lighting, should come on even before the sun sets, right? So institutional task tuning, color tuning, data generation, demand response, so institutional task tuning, color tuning. So all these are depending upon the task at hand and the ambience, mood, and the points that we spoke on in the previous slide. The data generation is to learn about our own usage in terms of the pattern, when was the maximum peak usage, can we optimize it further to reduce the usage and make it even more efficient, right? And the demand response, when there is a demand, is it really contributing, is it responding to the demand at hand, right? So with this we are done with this submodule, which is integration of daylighting with artificial lighting, control systems, and loss of illumination. So with this we have completed module 4, subheading 1. We started this module with, if I'm not wrong, quality and quantity of lighting. We spoke about the types of flams. We started with lux levels for various activities as per the standards, and we try to understand why there was a difference between the difference in the lux level between various terms. And we completed our first session for this submodule. And in this module we covered we started with laws of illumination, Lambert's cosine law and inverse square law. And we started with the integration of daylighting with artificial lighting, the strategies, the components, the design recommendation, and all this. And we again moved on to control systems, the types of control system, the types of again strategies over here, the components, how this can be strategized. And we also spoke about the passive techniques of borrowing daylight, right? So with this we are stopping this module, which which is your module number 4, subheading number 1. So in the next module, which is our fourth module, subheading number 2, we will be talking about ambient lighting, task lighting, and the accent lighting, the types of luminaires, what are the types of lamps that we can. Not over here we studied about the types of lamps, over there we'll talk about the ways particular space is getting lit, the strategies. So there we talk in more from an interior designer's perspective about the lights. It is called as luminaires. We will get to that. And next module, we will complete the next module or this entire module by preparing a lighting layout, and that should sum up this module, right? So see you in the next submodule, lecture number 15. Bye. Thank you.